this is Tony Lloyd. Being a broadcaster for many years, I've witnessed some great stories in the music industry, and now I want to bring as many music stories to you as I can in this series of podcasts. My goal is that they will inspire others making their way in the music world.
Music Stories with Tony Lloyd.
Chris Norman, welcome to Music Stories. Thank you for talking to me.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for asking me.
No problem. And in case people don't know who Chris Norman is, you'll remember the band Smokey. And you have had in your career, it says here, more than 20 solo albums since Smokey. Smokey was in the 70s, a big hit. I remember watching On Top of the Pops and so on. Probably your most memorable hit with Smokey was Living Next Door to Alice. And she sends her love, by the way. I'll Meet You at Midnight and Lay Back in the Arms of Someone. They're the three biggies, aren't they, really? They were the massive hits.
It depends where you go, you know, because some of the songs, I mean, like If You're Thinking Out of Love Me was the first hit, and that was a bigger hit than any of those three you just mentioned. That was got to number three in the UK. Mm-hmm. It depends which country you're in, you know. We had about 14 hits in the UK, I think, and a couple more in other countries. But we had a good little run at it.
Fantastic. Which was the most popular country, or the country that found you the most popular, do you think, back in those days?
Probably Germany, I think, because I never knew why, but we always used to, like, when we were doing shows and stuff, we'd be doing theatre tours, say, in the UK, you know, playing to 2,000 or 3,000 people a night. Mm. And at the same time, when we went to Germany, we were playing arenas.
Wow.
To playing to 10,000 to 12,000 people a night. So there was always that little bit of difference between the two. Mm-hmm. Plus the fact a lot of the records we had out went to number one in Germany. And we'd, like, say, for instance, you know, we'd get, like, number five was Alice, not the follow-up version, which came after I left, but the original version was at number five, and it was number one in Germany. And, you know, that was the kind of story. And quite a lot of places in Europe, actually. I mean, we had that sort of success. But Germany, I think, would have been, for some reason. And that's where I started my solo career, because my first big hit as a solo artist was a song called Midnight Lady, which went straight to number one in Germany and stayed there for 6 weeks. So for some reason, yeah, Germany's always been a really good market.
And that was 1986, which is going back some, isn't it? I mean, you've been around for a long, long time.
Yeah.
And I have to say you know, you're looking good for your age, I have to say.
Well, that's very kind of you. Yeah, I'm glad I came now.
Well, you're welcome. What's the secret?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I think... my genes are pretty good. My mum lived till she was 98. My grandma till she was like 2 weeks off 100. And, you know, they both look pretty good in their old age. So I guess that. And I try and keep myself reasonably in shape. Not that I'm a fanatic or anything, but, you know, I usually go for a walk or run or most days, especially if I'm coming up to a tour or something, just to keep myself up to get the energy level up, you know. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, maybe that's it, or maybe I've just photographed well, you know.
Well, yeah. And no Photoshop is used at all in the
creation. Nothing at all. Only everything you can find, that's all.
Brilliant. Well, we'll have a photo that goes along with this podcast with the text, so I'll pick a good one. Don't worry. Now, you've got another single out now, which is a version of Always On My Mind, which, of course, Elvis is probably most famous for singing, and an album called Rediscovered Love Songs. I'm really interested in that because of my show, Love From Tony. We'll talk about that in just a tick. But first of all, I want to find out how the music industry started for you back in the day. I mean, did you study it? How did you start in the music? Were you at school? What happened?
Yeah, no, I didn't study it. I never went to any. I mean, they didn't have courses for this kind of music in those days. They do now, of course. They have all kinds of, you know, rock, this, that, and the other courses. But no, First of all, I came from a showbiz background. Both my parents were in show business. My dad was in an act called the Four Jokers, who were kind of like a knockabout comedy thing, like a bit like the Marx Brothers, maybe. Mm-hmm. And they were, for the kind of act they were, worked all over the place. They did a Royal Variety performance back in those days. My mum was a singer, dancer. So I grew up with that sort of showbiz atmosphere anyway. Not that I ever wanted to go into it in that direction, because it didn't really interest me. But I kind of just got into music when I was about 6 or 7 years old. I had older relatives who were 9 years older than me. So they were listening to Buddy Holly and Elvis and Lonnie Donegan and all those people. So I got into them, those artists and all the others, Little Richard, from there, playing their records, you know. Mm. And that kind of, I think, sparked something off in me. And, of course, when the Beatles came out and the 60s beat thing, I was then a teenager. So I got a guitar. In fact, I got a guitar for Christmas same Christmas as Alan Silson, who was the lead guitar player in Smokey, got one, and we were at school together. Right. So me and Alan and Terry, actually the bass player, we were all at the same school. And when I came back after the Christmas holidays and I found out Alan got a guitar, we started to hang out together so we could show each other chords and find out we could sing pretty good together, nice harmony sound and everything. And then Terry came into the group a bit after that. We just started playing, you know, anywhere that we could get a booking, dance halls, youth clubs, you know, pubs, anywhere. And then Pete joined, Pete Spencer, who's a drummer. And that was, at that time, we were called Kindness by that time. And then we started making records around about 1969. We had our first two or three singles came out on RCA, which all flopped, incidentally. But we still kept, you know, plugging away. By this time we were playing up the length and breadth of the UK, everywhere we could. And we went, did stints, you know, doing other things. We backed Peter Noon. Remember Peter Noon from Herman's Hermits?
Yeah, I do.
We were his backing group for about a year. And still doing our own gigs at the same time. So we, you know, that's how I got into it. And it was just a matter of experience, and the longer we played, the more sort of different types of gigs we played, the different kinds of songs we played, was just all experience that we took in. And then luckily enough, after like 7 years of playing, doing that, we got our first success when we signed to Rack Records, which was Mickey Most's label. Mm-hmm. And that's when we first started to have some hit records.
Wow, brilliant. And why did you call the band Smokey?
Well, we were called Kindness, as I said, and it was a lousy name. Nobody ever remembered it. And they'd get mixed up, and people would announce it as Happiness or the Calendars, we got sometimes, because it sounded Kindness. What's your name? Kindness. Okay, the Calendars, you know, not the Calendars. Anyway, so it was not a good name, you know. And then when we signed, it was the record company really said, you could do with a better name than that. It's not good. And they thought of Smokey because of my voice, my kind of slightly croaky voice. They thought Smokey would go with that well. So that's why we got called Smokey. We had a bit of trouble with that when our first album came out in America, because, of course, Smokey Robinson was very big in America. Mm. And he was known by all the radios and everything as Smokey, you know, his Smokey's new one, meaning Smokey Robinson. Mm. So when we came along, and we were Smokey as well, they didn't like it, you know. Yep. So we had to change the spelling, because we were EY at the end, and we changed it to IE so we didn't get confused with Smokey Robinson.
That was neat. So, very good. I like that. Very clever. How many gigs must you have done since you started when you were a child? You must have done hundreds of thousands.
I don't know. I've never really sat down and worked it out, but, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's a long time. It's 54 years since we went professional.
Wow.
Not including the amateur times or the semi-pro times. So how many shows do you do a year? I don't know. Must be. It's in the thousands for sure.
Yeah. there can't be anybody who's really, not many people have got more experience of than you have doing live gigs on the road all the time. Do you find it really, do you enjoy it still on the road, or do you find it tiring? How do you feel about it all now?
Well, I tell you what, I really enjoy playing. I enjoy live audiences because there's nothing like playing to a live audience to get an instant reaction.
Yeah.
Instant reward, if you like. Whereas with a record, you've got to wait until it comes out and see people buy it or not. With an audience live, you get straight away, you get that reaction. So yeah. I love that. But do I get tired? I get tired of traveling, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and the older I get, the harder it gets, especially these days. I mean, at one time, traveling wasn't so bad as all that. But now, you know, with the security lines and the don't carry this on the aeroplane and you can't, that bag's too big and you can't put that in the locker and all, you know, all that stuff. You get a lot of that hassle. And so that's the time. And traveling for so long, you know, I quite often do stuff where I've got to get two flights to get to somewhere, which takes a while. And then when you get there, you've got another 2-hour drive or something. So it's like the traveling is the thing that makes you tired. And, makes you feel like, should I still be doing this? But then when you get there and you go on to a packed house and the audience are going crazy, then you think, that's why I'm here. That's why I'm doing it. Because that's the bit that's the fun bit, you know?
Yep. Understood. Tell me about your new album, Rediscovered Love Songs. How did that come about?
Well, I'd been... I just recorded in 2019. I'd recorded an ordinary album, an album with new songs. I mean, with Mike Chapman, actually, who was the producer of Smokey back in the 70s. And I hadn't seen him for a long time. And he came to a gig I was doing. And then I ended up going back a couple of days later, went down to his place in he lives in London now. He was in America for quite a few years. He lived in Los Angeles for a long time and then Connecticut, but he came back to London. And so I spent a couple of nights at his place and we just sort of reminisced and we just thought, why don't we record something again? So, you know, I'd been recording albums anyway, you know, every couple of years for the last however long. And so we went to the studio, recorded an album, which was called Just a Man, with 7 songs that I'd written and 4 that he'd written. We wrote a couple of songs together, which actually I've still haven't released. But so that was great fun to work with him again. Mm. But then the COVID thing happened.
Mm.
And so the album was delayed. It was supposed to come out and it couldn't come out. And then finally it kind of came out, but late. And all the promotional things that we'd arranged to do had gone. And so the album just kind of didn't really make any... Nobody sort of noticed it, really. I mean, it sold some, but it didn't sell many.
Hmm.
And then suddenly I found myself in the middle of lockdown after I'd done that album the next year and the year after. And I was a bit lost because a lot of the shows we were supposed to be doing were postponed.
Yep.
And I found myself sort of staring at the wall, wondering, what am I going to do? And I did a few bits and pieces for YouTube just to keep myself busy and little videos of me playing the guitar or doing whatever. And then somebody said, why don't you make another album? This was like about a year after I'd finished this album with Mike Chapman. And I said, well, I've got any songs left, you know. I've just finished an album. I've got to get back into writing first.
Yeah.
And they said, why don't you do a love songs album of other people's love songs? And I thought, well, yeah, I don't know. And then I thought, well, you know, the fan base that I've got, the age that they are, would probably enjoy that, you know.
Definitely.
So I just started to think about it. And then I asked loads of people I knew, friends, family, and so just, and I said, you know, do us a favor, make a list of all your favorite love songs of all time. And then I ended up with about 60 songs. So I kind of sifted through them and took out the ones that you think, oh, I'm not going to do that. Like Imagine by John Lennon, I'm not going to touch that. That's just, nobody should redo that, you know, not in my opinion. And certainly I'm not going to. But I just found the songs, ones that I'd already sort of thought of anyway, and then some others that were suggested, and came down to this 12 songs that's on this Rediscovered album that I've just got out. And basically the way that I did it with, could I sing them? Would I sing them good? Could I do anything with them that would make them more interesting for me, you know? Mm. And were the songs that if I heard them on the radio, would I turn them up? And that's how I kind of selected the songs. And yeah. And also I didn't want them all to be slow. I wanted them to have some mid-tempo. And it's difficult to find fast love songs or up-tempo love songs, because mm-hmm. most love songs, the nature of them is that they're kind of slow and romantic, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah.
So I made sure that I found a few that were up-tempo as well. And from different eras, I didn't want to do all new songs or old songs. So I've got, you know, the oldest one I think is My Girl, which was from about 1964-5 by The Temptations, yep. or Otis Redding. And that was the thing, that was quite often by different people. So I'd listen to Otis Redding's version of it and a Temptations version of it, and then do a version of my own. And taking the best bits from both that I liked, you know. And I did that with a lot of the songs. And then the newest one is probably Bruno Mars, Just the Way You Are.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's the newest song on there. Lady Antebellum, Need You Now.
Yeah.
Which is not new, but it's not old either, you know. So, and then just basically pick the ones that I really liked. I did, for instance, I Need Your Love So Bad, which was an old Fleetwood Mac song with Peter Green's Fleetwood Mac, not the Rumours one, but mm-hmm. the one from the earlier days. And I don't know if you remember that song. It was like a blues song, Need Your Love So Bad. Yep. And it was a big hit back in, I think, 68 or something. So I did a version of that and, you know, just basically took songs that I really loved to hear myself. And then it gave me something to do during lockdown, because mm-hmm. then instead of staring at the wall, I had a reason going at the studio every day.
Yeah,
I'd get up, go into the studio, work on this, and I was replaying everything myself because I didn't have access to other musicians. So I just played everything myself, all the different guitar parts, bass, and everything. I just the only thing I did was I was using like a drum samples,
yeah.
because I couldn't record drums. So when I'd finished the album and done everything, I took it to Nashville and got a drummer to play on it. And some keyboards that I'd not felt competent enough. I played most of the keyboards, but got a new keyboard player, because you get some great players down there. Mm-hmm. And then got a guy called Jake Burns to mix it, who was a Grammy Award engineer. And he did, I gave him my rough mixes and say, this is kind of what I want it to sound like, but you know, you make it shine, sort you know, it. Sort of thing.
Yeah.
And that was it. That was the album.
That's amazing. What's it like working in Nashville? It's on my list of places to go.
Well, you know, the thing about music, they call it Music City. Yeah. It is Music City. I mean, they've still got that kind of old ethos about going, getting a bunch of guys in the studio and everybody says, okay, let's go. And the people, the musicians down there are so good at that. Because, you know, I did stuff where I was recording one track and the guy came in to play. What did he play? What was he, bass player on something else? It was and then he was, as soon as he'd finished, he was off. And I said, where are you going now? He said, you've got to do a Dolly Parton session. They just go from one session to another, you know, every day.
That's amazing.
They just go in here, I'm doing that session, I'll be about an hour, then I'll go down there and do one with Dolly Parton. And that's what it's like. It's just a great place to be around if you're in the music business, you know.
Yeah, amazing. I always admire session musicians, because you know they just say, okay, what do you want? They play it and then they go home. In one take.
Yeah, especially if they're good, like they are, yeah. like they are down there in Nashville. They are good, you know. You can say, okay, let's go, and they just get it, you know.
Sure. You've seen a lot of technical changes in your career, obviously. I have.
Yeah.
In the radio absolutely. Industry, when I started, we were playing, you know, we had two record players and a microphone and a jingle machine. And that was it. You know, and you had to be entertaining just with that. But that was okay. It was good fun. But, you know, also producing music has changed as well. I mean, how have you found that?
Well, I was used to this, like you say. The first record we ever made was back in 1969,
mm-hmm.
and it was on an 8-track tape machine.
Right.
And then, of course, it got better and better. And then it was 24 track, and then they got 32 digital tracks and everything. Now it's Pro Tools,
yeah,
or another version of that, which Cubase or Logic or whatever.
Yep.
I use Pro Tools, and the thing is with Pro Tools, it takes a little while to get your head around it because you can't sort of do it in the same way as you used to. Mm. But basically, once you do get your head around it, it is pretty much the same thing. You know, you plug something in and mic it up or whatever, and but instead of going through a tape machine, it goes into your Pro Tools system. And the good thing is you can use plugins and stuff and for effects and compression and all that stuff. So you get all that. And the beauty of it is you can move things about so easily. So if you do a section that you think, I don't like the way that the arrangement, I wish I'd have done that a different, that bit should have come there. And you can just splice it and move it. Whereas in the old days, you had to get like a cutting board out and try and cut the tape and all that, you know, and splice it back together again. Yeah. Now you just move it. It's just so easy. So once I got the hang of it, and I've worked with it for quite a while now, it's actually really quite easy and quite, it's a simpler way of recording.
Certainly. Absolutely. It's good to have learnt the old way, I always say, because I learnt to edit, you know, with a razor blade and a China Graph pencil.
Yeah, exactly.
But if you can edit like that in a linear form on tape and with all the restrictions, then it's much easier to do it, I think, anyway. Maybe younger people may disagree with me.
Well, I guess so. And the other thing that, I've worked with other people who've been, like engineers, who've been used to doing the actual recording. And quite often they record track after track after track after track after track. If for instance, if you're doing back vocals and you want to do like six tracks of three people singing the same harmony, they'll just keep them in six parts or more. Or if they do a few guitar solos, they'll keep them all. So you end up with like 100 tracks, you know, to deal with at the end when you're mixing. I don't do that. I still have that old mentality where if I want to do six tracks of something, I'll do that, but then I'll bounce it down to a stereo pair. So I've got that control over it. I'd rather do that because that's where we used to do it. And I still prefer that because at the end, then you've got less to worry about. You know, you've already done some of the work before you get to the end. So
do you find that recording is a bit throwaway these days, perhaps, if that's the right term, where, as you say, you can record and record and record and record and they just press delete? A bit like photography, where people take 1,000 photos just to get one. I never understood that. You know, I just take, people call me one take Tony.
Well, I prefer that. I mean, I prefer that because I've done an awful lot of photo sessions in my life, and when they just chip, 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 and then at the end of it, you get like hundreds of photographs and you've got to pore over them to find the one that actually looks all right. Why not just concentrate and get like three or four that you really think are good while you're doing it?
Yeah.
And then take a few extras for safety and that's it. Move on to the next shot.
Yeah. Totally.
They do exactly what you say. They just take one after another and hope for the best.
Yeah.
And the same thing. Yeah. It's the same when you're recording. A lot of people do record loads of tracks. I don't. I kind of tend to, if I've got a guitar player doing something, I might record a couple of tracks so I can pick the best bits. But definitely I'll concentrate on one good track of his, you know, so that if he goes wrong, I say, well, it's great up to there. Let's just go in from there on the same track. And then I've got it still on that one track. I'll still do that. I mean, it's, why not?
That's great. That's great. I love that. You know, we're from the same era.
yeah, we are. And I think there was a lot to say about those earlier days, you know, especially before our time too, you know, when you look at the Sun Studios with Elvis recording and all them guys. I mean, they used to somebody wanted a solo, they just moved nearer the mic.
Yeah.
You know, they played it all at once. And then when somebody had a solo, they just walked a couple of steps forward so they'd be louder. which is great.
Well, they couldn't afford loads of microphones, could they, in those days? Probably, you know. So that was
Have the desks to plug them all into either.
No, that's right.
So they couldn't plug in like dozens of microphones into a desk. They didn't have that facility. So you get a kind of equality that comes from that. Mm. That you know, people now try very hard to emulate. You know.
Tell me about Top of the Pops in England.
Ooh, Top of the Pops. Well, we did Top of the Pops back in those 70s days. I think I counted it up to about 45 times.
Wow.
So we were on a lot. But the first time we ever did it was terrifying, I remember, because we were, you know, this is the show that you grew up on, you know, watching the 60s, all these bands like whoever it was, the Stones, the Beatles, the Kinks, whatever.
Yeah.
And then suddenly you're on it. And I remember going into the studio and all these people waiting for the rehearsal and Pants People. Remember Pants People?
I do. Dancers. Yeah, very well.
in the afternoon, sitting around in their hair curlers, waiting during the rehearsals and stuff. And then we had to go and do ours. And I remember being quite nervous. Although we had done a couple of other TV shows before we did Top of the Pop. So we kind of got used to the cameras thing and where to look and where not to look. And it was a bit less daunting, but still very nerve-wracking. But you know, once you start doing it and then you do it like the first time the record enters the charts, then you back 2 weeks later to do it again for the same record, and the third week and the fourth week. And then you do that for a few records. Suddenly you start getting to a point where it's like, oh, it's only Top of the Pops.
Yeah. You know, it's fine.
But it was a great show to do, and it was definitely a marvelous tool for promoting the record, because you get on Top of the Pops.
Big audiences.
And the record would just shoot up the charts the next week.
Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic. It sounds like great fun. Tell me about the future then. You got this album out, which we've mentioned, and we'll mention it again. But I had a sneaky peek at your website, which is chris-norman.co.uk. And we'll type that into the text that goes with it as well, because that would be easier than me trying to say it. And you've got a lot of gigs coming up.
Yeah, well, I've been doing a lot. I've been doing a lot of gigs this year. I started off at the beginning of the year with a mini tour of Russia. We did about 5 shows there. We couldn't do that now, of course, but this was in January. And then we went into the Ukraine, did a couple there. I don't think they even let you go from Russia to the Ukraine anymore. But anyway, that was the beginning. Then we went to Germany, did a load of shows there, and then we've just been working live here, there, and everywhere all year. And now we've got coming up in about 10 days, I'm going to India to do 2 festivals there.
Wow.
And then I'm coming back from there and doing some shows in Lithuania. And that'll take us pretty much to the new year. And then next year I start again. And I'm doing some shows in February in Ireland. And we're trying to tag on some UK dates at the end of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we onwards from there. I'm not sure what we're doing after that, to be honest, but there's a few shows coming up. Yeah.
Okay. That's amazing. Well, I can't see you ever stopping. I think you're one of these guys who will just carry on till you drop, to be honest.
I think I will. I think I'll know for either 2 reasons. One, the people stop coming to the shows, in which case I'm going to be going up. Well, promoters will tell me, we don't want you anymore. That'll be that. Or I'll get to, so that I don't feel well enough to do it or something. I don't have the energy to do it.
Sure.
So one of those 2 reasons will be the only way that I'll stop. Otherwise, I'll just keep going until I drop, like you say.
Fantastic. Chris, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Fascinating and great reminiscing as well. I've really enjoyed reminiscing with you about the techie stuff. That's been great fun. Good luck with Always On My Mind. I've listened to it and I think it's almost better than Elvis.
Don't tell him.
I'll try not to. So good luck with that. And of course, the album Rediscovered Love Songs as well. And I'll see if I can play a few of those on Love From Tony,
great.
My radio
show. Thank you very much.
I'm sure I'll be able to do that. Good luck for the future. Keep in touch. It's been lovely talking to you, Chris.
Nice talking to you too. Take care.
Music Stories is a free podcast with no fees paid to contributors in the hope that it'll help and inspire others in the music industry. Get in touch if you've got a story to tell. If you would like a professional podcast made or would like training so you can do it yourself, I can help. Go to tonyloydradio.com.
Music Stories with Tony Lloyd.